This is an episode with friend of show. Professor Adolph Reed Jr. And in this episode, we get the special added guest. His son, Teray, jumped on as well. You get double reads. Two times the reads, two times the fun. So, Teray is going to be quiet for a lot of it. Not all of the show, of course. Because he was reading the chat. Getting some giggles. You can't see it because you're listening, but definitely you could see when he read something funny because he would just laugh on camera. If you want to see this in real time, all the shows are in playlists for the days they air. If you want to see it live, Monday through Thursday, 6 p.m. Pacific time, and Saturday, 9 a.m. Pacific time, YouTube.com/ThisRevolution Podcast. On this episode, we're talking about Adolph Reed's book, The South. A bit of a memoir. I'm not going to lie. I was trying to read an excerpt from the book, and then everything went wrong with my screen at one time. And it's like, of course everything went wrong with my screen at one time. Of course that would happen to me. So frustrating. But the show was great. It's always fun to talk to Adolph. Love it when he gets to come on, and the fact that he had this new book. He had been telling us about this, actually, the last time he was on. He mentioned that he wanted to come back when the book was ready. Didn't know we were going to get the bonus of Teray. Teray had just was literally talking to Pascal. I was like, just give him a link. So I thought we were going to, you know, shoot the shit off air. And off air turned to on air. So let me read this quote now that I F up early in the show. Segregation was enforced on whites as well as blacks. That reality is obscured in a contemporary perspective that flattens out history and context into simple polarity of racism / anti-racism and reduces politics to an unchanging contest of black and white. That perspective compresses historical distinctions between slavery and Jim Crow and ignores the generation of struggle, often enough biracial or interracial, against ruling class power over defining the political and economic character of the post-emancipation South, as well as ongoing struggle against and within the new order as it is consolidated. In 1892, the same year Homer A. Plessy challenged the state's new Separate Car Act, black and white workers in New Orleans conducted a largely successful general strike in the face of the opposition's attempt to incite racial division among the strikers. That is from Adolph Reed's new book, The South. There are links in the description. Go get it now. That music means I've been speaking for too long. Hope you enjoy the show. The bonus half was spicy. I am out. evening, everyone, and welcome to another special Black History Month edition of This is Revolution Podcast. I am your host, Jason Miles, and if you are new to the show, please hit the like and subscribe button, and don't forget to hit the bell, as we are constantly adding new programming to the channel. So we want you to be ready and alert anytime we go live with something brand new. That being said, we have been busy in the This is Revolution universe. I was a guest yesterday on the David Feldman show. It's up on YouTube. I've been sharing it out on the Twitter, so please check that out. Tomorrow night, I will be on Bad Takes with Joe Payne and, of course, creator of the Anglo-Pessimism shirt, J. Andrew World, where we will be talking about one of my favorite movies, Better Off Dead with John Cusack. Also, my co-host and I, in our partnership with The Real News, have a new interview up with Yanis Varoufakis, where we talk techno-feudalism, but more importantly, we have a small debate on what's better, Star Trek or Star Wars. So without any further ado, let's bring in my homie, my dog, my co-host extraordinaire. He is the Pascal Robert.
Peace and greetings to the chat. Peace and greetings to the audience. Peace and greetings, Jason Miles. And all of you who have not gone to check out our Yanis Varoufakis interview on the Real News Network, do so too sweet immediately. It's a great interview. I checked it out again. Everyone who I told me they watched it, they liked it very much. So that will only probably be outdone by this interview.
And he really was throwing up Vulcan gang signs. Like, he was about that Star Trek life. He made that shit very serious to me that Star Wars is for punks, and he was living that Trekkie life. And so watch it just for that. And then he's apparently going to come on our show, and we're going to have a debate on what is better. And I'm all for it. Yanis, bring it. I know you're the finance minister and you know everything about this. Ain't about economics, goddammit. It's about quality cinema.
Okay.
That being said, does anyone know the album behind me? Pascal, do you know the album behind me?
Nah, man. That looks like some Evel Knievel shit back there.
It's close. Before we bring in our guests, we made a clip. By we, I mean me. So get ready for tonight.
Editor Horace Wells.
Well, any newspaper is inclined to follow the thinking of the majority of the people in the community, and this community and I myself have favored segregation all down through the years. Back when this lawsuit was filed in 1950, we did everything we could to maintain segregation by trying to provide the Negro students with good, equal, but separate facilities. And that was the way the community felt, and that's the way the community wanted it.
As a systemic social order, the purpose of segregation was to impose through law and social regulation a doctrine of white supremacy that established boundaries on the politically thinkable in much the same way that the anti-communism would nationally during the post-World War II decades. It is worthy of note as well that the victorious ruling class didn't impose the regime in most places until blacks and many poor working class whites had been taken out of the political equation by disenfranchising them. As Adolph Reed Jr. writes in the introduction to The South, he is constantly struck by how much the ways that things had changed in the South seemed to underscore the ways they hadn't. This idea of continuity being inextricably linked to change is one of the most important points to take away from this reading, in large part because it highlights the fact that Jim Crow was, in some respects, a malignant symptom of an even greater cancer that we have barely begun to address, how the architecture of the social system directs the content of people's lives and the individual and collective sense of who they are and what they deserve. We'll discuss Adolph Reed's latest book, The South, and more. This is Revolution.
With a new sense of dignity and destiny.
Negro Americans, my friends, are on the march for their rights.
Thank you for watching. Please don't forget to...
Well, all right.
Well, all right. Let's, before we bring in our guests, we have a surprise guest. It's a surprise. Didn't know we were going to get a twofer. We have coming all the way live from somewhere in the bowels of Illinois, the Touré Reed.
What? What?
The family affair, right? Here we are.
How did this happen?
The magic of texting and streaming.
What?
We were talking about this right beforehand. So
we were, but you thought you told me you had other obligations.
I do, but I'm here briefly. I just wanted to show my
Double read. They say double read, you get double readed.
There it is.
Oh, y'all are making my Black History Month special. Y'all are making this. It's not even black. It's cream colored because we got two light skinned niggas here.
Yes, yes, and usually when we have light skinned people on, it's to prove that we're not racist.
That's what it is.
All right, thank you for your service.
Yeah, that's yeah. And then when you leave, I just want you to know I make all the light skin jokes I possibly can, because I do believe you people are the ones that created the rumor that Negroes are always late. I say, no. Us darkies are on time. It's the light motherfuckers that's late.
Well, I do my part to be late as often as possible. It's my thing. It's my signature. See? So I'm ruining it for everyone.
Jason has his own kind of internal machinations with the light-skinned folks. I try to give him some therapy to combat.
I grew up in the 80s and the 90s when light-skinned dudes like that looked like Howard Hewitt with chest hair that looked like a shag carpet was taking all the women. So
that's by the time you came around, that started to change, man. You were in the Michael Jordan.
He's on the West Coast. It's on the West Coast.
That's true.
It's different. They was like breeding them. All the mixed dudes, DeBarge.
It was like that in the 70s when I was coming up, but Michael Jordan and Wesley Snipes put the kibosh in that.
Wesley Snipes, there. Jungle Fever, Scene 1, definitely put a kibosh on that. All the light-skinned dudes was messed up. Sorry, Touré.
I had a great time in the 90s, so speak for yourself. That whole thing was overblown, in my opinion.
Well, changing subjects. Often when we think of the past, we view it through the lens of a flattened understanding of the times. Segregation, as our guest explains in his latest book, and I would say a bit of a memoir, The South, was enforced on whites as well as blacks. That reality is obscured in a contemporary perspective that flattens out history and context into a simple polarity of racism, anti-racism, and reduces politics to an unchanging contest of black and white. That perspective compresses historical distinctions between slavery and Jim Crow and ignore the generate of struggle, often enough biracial or interracial, against ruling class power over defining the my screen just went out on my words. Damn it. Sorry about that. I fucked up. My screen just went up.
All right, Captain.
So without any further ado, I will make up for that loss. The Adolph Reed.
Hey, how you doing?
Thank you for joining us today, and thank you for dealing with my technical difficulties.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Like I said before, I'm just like I'm sitting here with a virtual shot of vodka, so we're gonna have a good time.
No, we're gonna have a good time tonight.
But I was looking at that photo that you guys found, man. But that was from an IATSE strike action in like Hyde Park in 1996 or 7. It's wild.
There's a lot of photos of you, you and your son, because you guys are professors and you write books. Of course, you have to have headshots. Mm-hmm. And I hate headshots. I hate taking headshots as a person that's been in the music industry. I don't know how to stand for them. So I try to find action shots. Either one of you are like musicians. It's hard to find action shots. But I was surprised to find that when I almost asked Teray if he had any throwback photos he could send me. In the mustache years, I think
Jason likes to go into the Wayback Machine and find the oldest picture of you. He can forget all the other rationalization. If you can find a picture of you in 72 trying to have an afro in off, and I know that wouldn't be happening, he would have taken it and put it.
You might have had an afro.
What about that driver's license picture?
Yeah, I'm gonna send it. It's an ID picture, but yeah,
okay, that's what it was.
Yeah, I'll send it to you right now.
It's like Ron O'Neill as a hijacker.
Right. Like Ron O'Neill when he was in Red Dawn talking Spanish, and he was like,
Ron O'Neill is Superfly, but commandeering an airplane en route to Cuba.
But listen, I know there's gonna be a lot of comedy that's gonna pop off while I got you here, but I just want to say both of Torrey is a very good friend of mine. We talk frequently. Jason, I see all the time, so I don't have to acknowledge him right now. But Torrey is a good friend of mine. We talk all the time. Adolph, we've been emailing back and forth for probably over a decade.
And, I think that's right. Yeah.
And but you know, me becoming close to Torrey, I feel like vicariously I get all the 411 on your life through him. Because, you know, as most people know and detest about me, I'm very much influenced. More so from Bruce Dixon, who exposed me to you, of you are actually more simpatico in your views of black politics than I think both of you had ever realized. And sadly, one of the tragedies for me personally, Bruce told me this, that you guys had never had the opportunity to meet.
No, that's right. Yeah.
One-on-one.
Yeah.
But, Bruce was a very, very strong admirer of your work.
And he actually was a very strong admirer of Bruce's work too, man.
Yeah, Bruce actually introduced me to you. And I remember the first email I sent you was an article I wrote in the Black Commentator called The Revenge of the Good Blacks. And you said, oh, yeah, we're basically fellow travelers. I said, first thing I said after reading some of your work, I said, I wish I had been aware of you in the 90s. I would have been able to understand why these Negroes are so jacked up back then instead of having struggled through all this on my own all this time. But it's Black History Month. I got both Reeds who I consider friends, almost family, and I'm very happy. I just wanted to say that so we can get down to this book.
All right, well, cool. Well, thank you, brother. I appreciate it. And I just sent you the photo in question.
Oh, shit, he did. We're going to share a screen, but I'm going to wait.
What year was this? Something. Very, you had like 73 or two?
74.
74, okay.
Yeah.
So, Professor Reed Sr., what prompted you to write this book? I know it has a bit of a memoir feel to it, which I really, really dig. But what was the impetus? What were you doing? Was it just the contract was up and you had to do something?
No. I'll tell you what it was. Two of my good friends, one 6 years older, the other 10 years younger, both with like roots in the Deep South. And I started talking really around the turn of the century, just kind of musing. But the kind of shit you do over a drink about how when our, you know, rough cohort left the stage of history, there'd be no one around anymore with any direct and organic lived connection to the Jim Crow era. So we, you know, we talk about that every now, not now and then. And then around 2002 or 2003, I just started writing with no particular objective. And I kind of quickly wrote myself, I've said this on a couple podcasts lately, but I kind of quickly wrote myself into that 15,000 word no person's land, right? That's too long for an article and too short for a book. And at that point, it was like, you know, some general overview stuff and a handful of vignettes. And it just kind of languished in that state for a number of years. I'd make a half-hearted attempt to try to get it published somewhere in some form, right? I was thinking more of an article than a book. And when we were out, actually, at the Southern Historical Association a number of years ago with Barbara Fields, I mentioned it to her, and she asked to see it. And then she basically insisted that I publish it. And she first put me in touch with a friend of hers who was an editor, who ironically lived across the street from where I lived in New Haven, or around the corner. And she supported the idea, but she wanted me to put like more of myself in it. And I was kind of resistant to that. And then I mentioned it to my former agent, Faith Childs in Manhattan. And she asked to look at it. And she got back to me with like a dozen or 15 specific things to do. And that's what I needed. So I did it. And Verso liked it. But the interesting thing was Faith tried to sell it to trade presses, including what used to be called Nation Books. It had just changed its name then. And the response that she got from acquisition editors was that they didn't know what to make of it, right? I mean, they didn't know what kind of book it was supposed to be. And the woman who was a Nation editor, or the former Nation editor, said that when she saw that the proposal was coming in with a project by me, she got excited, but then she read the prospectus and couldn't figure out what the hell it was supposed to be. So, but fortunately, Verso liked it, and that's how it became a book.
That's what's up. Well, listen, Adolph, this is it's a joy for me, not only because it's Black History Month, but you put down some markers in this book that are very, very important in clarifying. This book is a clarification. That's the way I look at it. That's why I define it.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Because
thank you.
And I knew where you were going with it, and you can tell me. I think you said something in the beginning of the book that I found fascinating, is that you stated, that's an interesting picture, you said that it was important, or you basically stated that Jim Crow has more to do with the current situation of American politics vis-a-vis Black America than slavery. Now, for me, who has been reading your work and been affiliated with Bruce Dixon for years, that's not a controversial statement.
Right.
But in the context of the where we are in today's contemporary Black thought, we're going to have a long conversation about that phenomenon.
Mm-hmm.
It would particularly seem strange to some people who, number one, think slavery is the center fulcrum of all Black life, and number two, many of our contemporaries of various ages, for various reasons, who like to romance Jim Crow and say everything was good back then, and it was integration that messed us up.
Yeah, you know, like on the latter point, like every time I hear that, right, I mean, my thought is, you know, I wish I could just take that motherfucker and like drop him for like 6 weeks in the Mississippi Delta in 1950 and like to go back and pick him up.
I feel like you could drop him now in the Mississippi Delta because that person doesn't live in the South and they'd be terrified.
Oh, yeah, totally. Well, yeah. Joe Wood said to me once, he was talking to Paul Gilroy, and this was in the 90s, who was pontificating about America, which, you know, the Black Brits like to do on the way to picking up those Black status jobs. And Joe asked Gilroy if he'd ever been to the South. And he said to Gilroy, oh, no, I'm afraid. And Joe said, yeah, well, you know, it's kind of hard to, you know, get a handle on this country's history if you don't spend any time there at all. But yeah, people tend to romanticize it, right, a lot.
Well, right, the particular reason why it really pisses me off is, number one, most of the folks who do it are from my generation who never lived during Jim Crow.
Right.
Number two, they think that the picture they have about one guy who happened to own, like, a lollipop shop is the epitome of Black capitalism and Black business.
Right.
And number three, what bothers me is that a lot of the Negroes who say this are major thought leaders in the age in which YouTube is giving political education or some education to whole segments of Black America, and they're actually academics.
Right. Well, and the last part is what's really most frustrating and disturbing, isn't it? I mean, because there have always been people like in barbershops, right? Or right on the street corner, right? I mean, with wisdom, basically, of a homespun sort. But yeah, but that this has become conventional wisdom among people who are supposedly paid to be scholars is quite something, right? Well, I tell you what, like a friend of ours, when we mentioned that a recent encounter with a precocious grad student who made a reference to the non-event of emancipation that's kind of rolled off his tongue like something everybody understands. And I've learned as a result of that from the friend that that this is the line that the Afro-pessimists like Saidia Hartman and what was that slave brother's name? The one from Minnesota?
Wilderson.
Oh, yeah.
Slave brother. Oh.
I mean, he said it.
That's right, he did. Like, right. So I mean, I don't know if he had a Mandingo fantasy plan in his head or what, man.
So, I don't even want to speculate.
What was that Wilderson reference there?
Oh,
I got to be so heavy to say it. You totally pushed it on me.
It was in an interview, and somebody asked him, well, I don't want to pry, but how do you square this, the whole rest of the world comes together around anti-Blackness with the fact that you're married to this white woman? And he said, well, I'm her slave.
Yes, he did.
But you know what? You know one thing that we're leaving out of that slave comment and the other comment about if I'm nothing, you're nothing, we're nothing together. With
Right.
That was another
one. We're leaving out the fact that, you know, when you come from the literary world and your goal is to sell books, you have to lay it on a little thick.
I guess you do.
That's why we're talking about him, because he lays it on thick.
Yeah.
Well, let me tell you, I have a specific question that deals with contemporary Black thought that I want to get to. Because listen, we could do this all night because this is too good, and we don't want to do that. But address the first question for us, Adolph. Why is Jim Crow the appropriate way to frame the correlation of contemporary Black politics today as opposed to slavery?
Did you want to prep it, son? Because the Teray looks like he wants to say something.
No, so I'm just reading the chat. I'm just checking.
Pascal keeps ignoring the fact that we have young Reed. He's supposed to pass it to the dad. We're supposed to see the back and forth. Wonder Twins.
Well, we just did that. So, I mean, yeah. I'm here to enjoy the ride, and I'm not saying the whole time.
Us.
This is his dad, man. I mean, he doesn't get a chance to hang out with his dad on screen all the time with two Black folk. They doing it with Jacobin people all the time.
Oh, there's the shade.
You don't never want us to get white people to watch this show, huh? Damn.
Yeah, I've been thinking this for a while, Pascal, but I'm going to see if I can get you one of those Captain Crunch hats like Garvey had. Well, look,
like whenever you yell about that shit, you got to put on your Garvey hat.
We're going to talk about that too, man. You know, I want us to get. We might save that for the Patriots only, but we're going to talk about. We're going to clear a lot of air, man. Read Vindication Night.
All right. Well, all right. So let me address this one. One reason is kind of simple, right? That slavery was a long, long time ago. And I mean, Jim Crow, the Jim Crow era was the kind of formative racial experience for Black people for the first half to two thirds of the 20th century, right? I mean, when you think about it, the insofar as a substantial majority of the black population lived in the South for as long as that happened, or for as long as that was the case, legal and formal segregation, right, codified racial hierarchy, and disfranchisement were part or were components of the essential experience of most black people in the country. And the most immediate source of contemporary black politics, that is post-1965 black politics, was an outgrowth of the struggles in the post-war era on near both sides of the Cotton Curtain for jockeying for position in pluralist politics, like in cities, and the struggle against overcoming, or the struggle to overcome, that codified racial exclusion and hierarchy and its implications. And slavery had been over, right, for 100 years, except in that one little corner of Texas, when the Voting Rights Act was passed. So it, and I mean, frankly, like, well, and the different versions of the legacy of slavery stuff, and there have been several different ones, they always seem kind of weird to me, because they call for us, like, to overlook everything that happened between slavery and whatever the moment was when we started counting, right? And if slavery, I mean, therefore, was, well, yeah, if slavery was more powerful than any other black experience or experience that black people had, well, how could that be, right? Right, and how did it count more than everything that came after it counted? So it just seems clear on its face that what we think of as contemporary or post-1965, post-civil rights era, black politics had to have emerged most immediately out of the era that directly preceded it, not slavery. And I think another problem is, of course, that for many, or for way too many, if not most people of whatever race, how people think about the black American experience in this country is like, till 1964, right? There's like a blur, right? This kind of a blob of the bad old timey times that were first, or at one point called slavery, and at another point called sharecropping or Jim Crow, whatever. And part of the problem is precisely that people think that what's defined the black American political situation is an abstraction called racism, not the substantive institutions that structured their presence, frankly, and existence. Was that an adequate response?
That was good. I want to let Tori come in if he wants to jump in as well, if he wants some clarifying statements.
Well, I have a question, and it will require my dad to go back to when he was still teaching, which isn't that long ago. Did you find when you were professoring, or is the verb professing? I don't know.
Probably professing, I'd say.
That would make more sense than professoring. But when you were professing, did you find that often enough with students, their perspective when they walk into the classroom on black life was that there was slavery and then nothing? Maybe slavery and Reconstruction if they're more sophisticated, and then nothing until the tired seamstress decided not to give up her seat at random. And right. As a result, so we got that, and that's certainly the experience that I've had. But as a result, did it seem as if what students, and they're a small proxy on to America writ large, that their perception of black life came down to often enough blacks having kind of racial memory. Mm-hmm. And now maybe that framework has unfolded into an epigenetic but two versions of the same thing, understanding of slavery. I mean, just since I'm still teaching, I get from students regularly, even in my classes in the 20th century, just sort of reflexive reflections on slavery as if it's directly pertinent to what we're talking about in the 1940s, and not just rhetorically pertinent. And often enough, it is rhetorically pertinent, but it ends up displacing what's actually before Black subjects or Black subjects in their lived experiences in the 40s mm-hmm. or 2020s. So would you mind elaborating on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, let me tell you one thing. Like, I mean, I always felt kind of uneasy about this, but frankly, you are the first person whom I've known to draw the hard line on it, right? With our respect to undergraduates, but use of the first person plural to refer to stuff that happened to Black people like in 1840 mm-hmm. or in 1880, right? And it's something that's insidious there, right? I know why it happens, and I was there, right, when it got defined as the right.
Explain what people what that means. A lot of people don't understand. You're saying that when Black folks say things like, we went through hell when we were getting whipped in the plantation in the cotton field.
Right, right, exactly. Right, and the only way to respond to that is what, well, there are more elaborate ways to do it, but when Ture was a graduate student and people would write exams that use constructions like that, he's just writing the margins. So were you alive in 1840? What do you mean? Right. But that construct itself implies something like racial memory. Right.
Epigenetics, which I hate.
Right. And it's a small step, right? Like it's embedded as kind of, but I'm not just folk knowledge, but folk knowledge that implies a sense of belonging and respect, but the fact is that it rests on racist premises.
Right.
Now, has that gotten...
And on premises that are literally racist, right? The quintessence of racism.
So in just keeping it, I don't know, the high point of your career as a professor, so we'll mm-hmm. skip the graduate student days and begin mm-hmm. with your time at Yale and then your retirement from Penn. Did it get better or worse with time, or was it a constant?
It was pretty much a constant. Like the bellwether for me was the undergraduate Black politics course that I taught. And I always taught it with a kind of historical focus, right? So, in fact, we were talking about this a few days ago too, Ray, but one of the things I did, like I started it with emancipation. And one of the things that I did was had students, one of Eric Foner's big coffee table book on the Reconstruction has a compendium of Black people who were elected to office in the South between 1868 and 1877. And there's more than 400 of them. So I had the students read through that list, read a bunch of other stuff, like the first chapter of Jack Blum's book, Class, Race, and the Civil Rights Movement, or I'm probably screwing the title up, but which is a really good, thick account of the 30 years between emancipation and the end of the century, right? I mean, Judith Stein's great, of Mr. Booker T. Washington and others, but you know, essays and other stuff that, you know, kind of talks about, Pascal, I know you mentioned this, the Colored Farmers Alliance, and other forms of autonomous political activity that Black Americans engaged in, right? So I spent a week and a half or 2 weeks on that. And then, but for most of the time, or for most of the time I was teaching, most versions of that course that I taught, then you get to Washington and them, right? And what struck me was that almost all of the students would snap back again to a view that the freed people weren't really ready for freedom, that they needed tutelage. And I say to them, so Well, did your brain go to sleep on you last week? I mean, this is what you just read last week. So how do you put that together with this? But it began to get better toward the end. And as I've said, the best undergraduate course that I've taught, that I taught in my entire career, was the last one. And it was that Black politics course in my last semester of teaching. And I mean, Touray joked with me at the time and said, well, yeah, well, was that tempt you to change your mind? And I said, look, it took me 38 years to get this one, right? And you know, I don't have another 38 years to wait for the next one. And plus, I got to feel like Ted Williams, who's the only Red Sox player I really liked. Right, I hit a home run my last at bat. But
I want to address a question directed to me. Someone asked us.
Not even Jim Rice, huh?
Someone asked, does Pascal not believe in epigenetics?
I take that back, Rice. Although, just for one second. A good friend of mine, Jason Cameron, mm-hmm. Today, who grew up a Red Sox fan up in New Hampshire. But in those years, my boy's line was that the Red Sox were the only team that couldn't play Tony Armas and Jim Rice on the same day because it'd fuck up the racial quota. Sorry, but we just had to get that sports thing out of the way, man.
Someone asked a question. Pascal. Does Pascal believe in epigenetics? I know I think epigenetics is horseshit. I'll tell you why I think epigenetics is horseshit. Because if you can say that you have the physical memory and scarring and the actual biological context of what it was like to be a slave, you know what the ruling class would say? Good, we'll make you a slave again.
Yeah.
Well, so there's a related question in the chat too that's worth considering. Are you saying that cultural legacies don't leave powerful traces with their own causal logics? So, and I think it's an expression of the same question.
Look, I can. Right. I'm going to tell you guys a true story.
Okay.
On why epigenetics is real.
Yeah.
I was working out at the park.
Right. The last years ago. That's correct. Yeah.
Uh-huh. I was working out at the park years ago, and I had one of those resistance bands. And I was like, you know what? And someone was like, if you wrap around a tree and do the like
it's
like press. And I was doing it and I was hitting it and I was like, yes.
Yeah.
And that shit snapped and it hit me in the back. And I screamed because I felt the pain of all of my ancestors. That moment. And I'm to this day terrified of those elastic bands, and I think they're racist. So there you go.
Whenever these horseshit theories come around, can everyone do any research of the genetic utility of these theories and how they stem from genetic early 20th century thought?
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. Right, right. Well, here's the thing about the epigenetic stuff, though, right? People who do, genetics for a living have understood the gene. The gene-environment interaction for a long time, right? And that's all at the core of it. The core scientific claim, right, to epigenetics, is just that genes don't determine things, right? I mean, genes aren't like homunculi, right? Or homunculus. I forget which declension. What the noun is, but and the genes are the developmental pathways of a given gene are first of all shaped by the interaction of multiple genes in ways that we don't know and understand, but they're also shaped by the environment of the gene, both within the cell and external environment, outside the body of the creature, right? And I mean, that's all it is. But what happened was 10-15 years ago, biodeterminists like Nicholas Wade, who was at that point Times's science writer, started doing a mea culpa about their genetic determinism and embraced a version of what they considered to be the epigenetic improvement. But what it was really was that they thought they'd found a hiding place for themselves to make the sources, that by making the sources of what was then in their minds still ultimately a genetic determinism, clouding the pathways and the mechanisms with reference to environmental factors that they didn't really pay any attention to anyway, except insofar as they could try to make a claim for something like a racial memory. So, yeah, I mean, you're right. But from that perspective, with respect to race theory, the way that people try to use epigenetics now is just in the same way that they use neo-Lamarckianism, like at the turn of the 20th century, right? But that brings home like a key point here, that the difference between a culturalist understanding of or a culturalist, yes, I think she's full of shit like a Christmas turkey. But that's Joy. I mean, DeGruy is also
the traumatic slave syndrome. You're busy here,
right?
Can you explain Lamarckian philosophy for our lay people, if you don't mind?
Yeah, sure.
You want to hit this because you did a very good explanation on my Facebook page for those who are not aware of it.
I did. Oh,
you did.
Cool. I'll defer to the star of the show on is Lamarckian race theory. Specifically, right? You don't want
Lamarckian theory. The difference between the Lamarckian concept of evolution and the Darwinian one is, and this is kind of overdrawn, but the Darwinian one is that changes that the organism experiences after birth don't have any impact on or aren't heritable, right? I'm like in any way. And like this is before, and like this was an understanding even before like the rediscovery of the gene, basically, right? The Lamarckian view is that experiences that the organism has after birth can be transmitted. So like the classic example of like the Lamarckian view is the giraffe whose neck grows longer from trying to reach the higher branches or leaves on the eucalyptus tree. If his or her neck is elongated by that practice, that's how they transmit like the longer necks to their offspring. And it's important to keep in mind, like at this point, I mean, nobody had a clear theory of heritability the way that we do now, right? So the way that it played out in terms of race theory in the late Victorian era was that the Darwinian race theorists believed that the differences between races were fixed in biology and that there was no way that they could be changed, right? And the Lamarckian race theorists thought that their take was like a vague blend of biology and culture, right? So they tended to be the seemingly more egalitarian ones because the Lamarckian race theorist views kind of opened the possibility that the gap between the races could narrow. And as Du Bois pointed out, like, you know, as between the two that were on offer, that's the one that made sense for us to adapt, right? But he balked at the at the standard view that it would take at least 1,000 years for the lesser race to catch up to them.
Yeah, because part of the Lamarckian race analysis is the belief that Black people were 2,000 years behind whites culturally, and it would take that long for them to catch up.
And that, right. that's part of the, what was going on with someone like Samuel Chapman Armstrong, that Pascal, right. who Pascal and I were talking about fairly recently.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Samuel yeah. Chapman Armstrong, who was the mentor, teacher, and godfather, the rabbi to Booker T. Washington.
Right.
We don't have time to get into that conversation. That's a whole show. I might have to invite you back to a special Mau Mau hour for that, but we're not going to go there now.
This yeah, I would love it.
Well, Pascal's been on a deep dive with HBCUs lately. We'll and,
We'll talk to Jason about inviting Adolph for a Mau Mau hour. We have I have my own show called the Mau Mau Hour. We might have you might do one on Booker T. Washington. That's right. We're doing the Mau Mau Hour tomorrow too, but it's going to be on a different subject. But I want to get back to the book because there's a lot of gems here that I want to get, and we're short on time. Please explain. This is very important. More than I think you realize. And I didn't understand this until I started reading your material, believe it or not. Why does Jim Crow start after Plessy versus Ferguson and not after the 1877 Hayes-Tilden Compromise? And define both and make that clear, please.
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, like the first answer is that things don't move in an automatic way like that. Another dimension of it is that, you know, most politics is local, right? So black people are participating, they're voting. They're electing people. And there were elements of even like the Bourbon elites who tried to find ways to accommodate black voting, right? I mean, not necessarily egalitarian ways, loading up the truck on the plantation and like giving ballots marked for the Democrat, right, to to all the field hands, which is one of the things that pissed off whites, upcountry whites, right, was how the planters used the majority black population in the black belt to control politics, right, through a different kind of fraud. And of course there were different responses to black political autonomy, like in different places, right, and more less concerted than random, I suppose. Depending on when were you talking about. But the big push was the populist insurgency. And as you know, right, there'd been one, the readjuster movement in Virginia had elected a governor and a senator, and other officials, and it passed tax laws favorable to working people, and in fact, and another irony is that like the titular head of that movement was a former Confederate general named Mahone. So the ruling class had been anxious, right? I don't want to overstate it, but they had been concerned enough about the possibility of blacks and poor and working class whites forming an electoral coalition or alliance against them. The populist uprising was like the nightmare come true. And as soon as they put that down, right, the first move was to take blacks out of the political equation via disfranchisement, and then to install a regime of white supremacy that demanded, in the words of former North Carolina governor who had like a classroom building named after him on my campus, Aycock, that they needed the strength that come all the white people thinking alike. So, like, that was their version of what the black people are doing now.
Now, Halo, let me tell you, you're moving a little fast because I got a whole question on this subject. The first thing I want to tell you is that probably the most important piece of political information I got was not from you, but it was from a book that you put together in an anthology, and it was a piece that was written by Judith Stein. Probably in all of my life, the most important thing I've ever read in terms of scholarship about Black history is that.
Yeah.
Because what is in that piece, and I have here in front of me right now, from Jim, and as scholars of Black thought and African Americans, you will realize I have The Betrayal of the Negro by Rayford Logan. Mm-hmm. This is chapter 5 of Racial Molding. The populist revolt threatened briefly to halt the triumphant march of the South back to the way of life it had mapped out for the freedom prior to the federal government's attempt to organize its own program of Reconstruction. Distressed white farmers in the South temporarily laid aside their racial animosities and joined Black farmers and workers in order to alleviate their common grievances. But the economic program of the populace floundered on the shoal of free silver, and the racial solidarity concept was overwhelmed by a new tide of demagoguery. Cleveland's second administration was so beset with national and international problems, the Panic of 1893, free silver, the populist revolt, Hawaii, Venezuela, and Cuba, that he had little opportunity to stop the steady deterioration of the Negro status. He probably concluded that the Southern question was definitely settled when Booker T. Washington won national acclaim for his Atlanta Compromise speech in September of 1895. In the following year, the United States Supreme Court consolidated the triumph of the former slave states when it sanctioned the doctrine of separate but equal accommodation.
If I hadn't read that in a long time, and I still suspect that that Logan, for whatever reason, may have been a little kind to Cleveland. I don't know, but I tell you what, on the Stein essay. I understand your reaction to it because I encountered it shortly after it came out. I was in graduate school, and my friend and advisor and one of the two comrades that I was having this discussion with that led to that book. I can't remember whether he passed it around or assigned it in a course, but like that article had very significant impact on this cohort of, you know, red inclined Black people, like in the AU political science department. And I mean, people that we've taught and people that they've taught, right, have kept the peace alive.
Well, listen, I want to get to this question because I want to, listen, we have a few minutes and we're going to go to the patron, but we're going to spend the rest of the time talking about the populist movement. And I framed this question in a way that I think you would appreciate. I think, and this is sincere, I think one of the biggest tragedies of the way Black history is taught in this country, and particularly during Black History Month, is that there is almost no discussion of the nature of Black political activity during the populist era. And I want you to know that this is my favorite period of Black political activity. And I think that the Colored Farmers Alliance is the greatest Black movement of organization in the history of Black America. Can you please tell our audience why Jim Crow was basically a ruling class response to an interracial challenge to American capitalism and the political duopoly from a grassroots movement of sharecroppers and farmers who are both Black and white?
Well, I think you just did it. Right? I think you just said it, right? I mean, and keep in mind, too, there were 60,000 Black members of the Knights of Labor, right, also, and with 6,000, I think, in the state of Mississippi alone. So there, and see, this is one of the strengths of that Stein article, too, which is that she makes the point that with the consolidation after World War II of this thing that we know as Black history or Black political history, one thing that happened was that the nature of how the universe of what counts as Black political activity got defined was that only stuff that bears directly on race or on combating racism counts as, you know, black political activity.
And right? Also, so, only black political activity that is divorced of interracial, cross-racial coalitions.
Right. Right. No, that's right. Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, the reality is that never was, well, that's not how black people, by and large, had gone about doing their politics, right? And certainly not in the late 19th century. So yeah, but I think you gave the explanation, man. And I mean, that's also part of the work that race does, right? And the one point I make in the book is that race ideology and racial hierarchy, well, it was definitely most aggressively and immediately and catastrophically imposed on black people, was also an ideology that was imposed on white people. And by that, I'm not trying to suggest that, you know, Southern whites would have been drawn to like the interracial harmony or whatever. But closing off the possibility of any effective kind of interaction, right, was part of, you know, a divide and conquer thing. Because among other things, like, it set the parameters of politics among white people, right, which were the only politics at that point, on terms of very sharply skewed to the upper class's concerns and interests, right? That's part of the explanation. It's kind of a simple one. I know somebody in the chat is concerned that I don't seem to have a cultural analysis. I'm not even sure I know what that means. But often people say, well, why is the labor movement weak in the South? And you get all this cultural exceptionalist bullshit. Oh yeah, that's right. Somebody else asked what I thought about the work of the young C. Van Woodward. I like it a lot. But the line is, so I'm gonna stop looking at the chat for a while. But the line is
draw you in.
Yeah.
Well, you know, go ahead, continue it off.
Well, that Southern culture was conservative, backward, but all you need to know really, right, is that disfranchisement altered the capacity to shape the political agenda in ways that effectively cut the working class of whatever color out of politics, right? So white workers had to find ways to craft or to define and pursue their own interests within a political universe that's set entirely by the upper class. And I want to say this too, like, and this kind of speaks a bit to the Woodward question too. But like my father, when I was a kid, and he said this often, the orthodox understanding among liberals, what was that Jim Crow was the product of the empowerment of the white working class in the South after the populist movement. And my father would always say, yeah, gee, that's funny, isn't it? Like, wouldn't you think that if they came to power, that they'd want to do something for themselves, right? They wanted to do something besides just piss on black people, right? So it was always a preposterous idea. But by contrast, right, that there was no Governor Altgeld, right, like any place in the South, right? That there were no few cases where, you know, mayors or governors would hold back use of state power to support strike breaking, for instance. One case was Mayor Fitzpatrick in New Orleans threw his support behind the 1892 general strike. But by and large, all elected authority in the South was unmitigatedly on the side of the ruling class. And you know, that adds up over time.
Well, listen, I got to get this last question in, and this is going to be a hot one.
Okay.
Pascal, all you can do is ask it. because he can't answer it because we're over an hour.
Oh, okay. I'm going to re-ask it.
Yeah.
So we can take it
all well, you and fast.
Make it snappy, nappy. Okay.
I told Torrey that I was going to post a meme on Facebook today, but he showed me. He said, I showed him the meme and he said, "Up, oh, no, hold that off." Then I said, he said, "Now hold it off." The meme said, "I love reading Adolph Reed's books because they always include so many references to show how dumb as rocks most of today's black academics are. And I want to have a serious conversation with you to show exactly why black thought today, especially black thought in the post-civil rights era, is as bad as it is and why it completely neglects the intricacies of all of this history." And one of the reasons I want to talk about how dumb as
that rocks was all on the meme?
Some of these folks can be.
That's not a meme.
Is it?
It's a manifesto.
No, it was going to be a meme. Tori saw it. It was going to be a short meme. The part where it says that, you know, I love
you. You created this?
What did you say?
You created this.
Yeah. Tori, did you see it?
I saw it.
I didn't. Don't ask him if he saw it. I'm asking you if you created it.
I'm not asking for proof
that this shit exists. What are you doing making memes?
It's one of those Facebook memes where you put a big post in bold and it's big in big letters.
You did you write the essays?
Anyway,
okay. Well, thank you, Reed family, for joining us.
Oh, sure.
Like I promised on the show Saturday, I guess I got to get a plane ticket to Miami to tisk tisk Pascal to his face.
So now you guys are going to do a Patreon, right? That's what's going on.
Yes, we're going to go. We're going to go and have the ask the real questions.
Okay.
And the real questions people want to know is, how does Adolph Reed feel about Brian Flores and Pascal's Miami?
There you go.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Yes, that's the real question. Because I have my answer on the whole thing. And you know, I'm wearing my colors today.
Yeah. Because well, I'm letting him know. I got to say, man, but I was thinking about this, Jason. Like, your comparative lack of sympathy for the lament of the black coaches is, on the one hand, refreshing and endearing, right? And chastening, right? So, so I think there's a lot to it. And then on the other hand, I think, yeah, kind of black people who are on your roof to the Denver Broncos would be like that.
Hey, first ever black starting quarterback in the modern NFL.
I know. You brought
they cut his ass the next year, but that's not the point.
No. You brought that's a good to my reason, attention.
But it's still Denver.
And I tell you what, man, there's another brother in Atlantic City who works for the or he's a leader in the Casino Workers Union, who is from New Jersey, but he's also a Denver fan, and like he sometimes shows up at meetings wearing Mets colors. And whenever I see him, I say, "No, motherfucker, I know what you're doing."
Is he in his 40s? Is he in his 40s?
Yeah, he is.
If you grew up in the 80s, there was no black quarterbacks. And late 80s, Randall Cunningham came.
And I watched the CFL for a while as a teenager.
That's the only place you saw Negroes was in the CFL.
Yep. Yep. Yeah,
with John Elway was as close.
I wonder what ever happened to so and so, and you go find him in the CFL.
And you must have turned me on.
John Elway for years was like as close as we got. Yeah. Like when we played football in the street.
We're talking now. I could have been talking about the academics who I think are dumb as rocks.
Yeah, you could have. A lot of shit you could have done.
I wouldn't mention no names.
You make a meme about that? Meme man.
I wasn't going to mention no names, but I was explaining to them why they're dumb as rocks.
Mm. All right. Well, I hope you have a delightful Patreon, and I will check in with you all tomorrow.
The champagne room?
No, I got stuff to do, man. But
he's already in trouble.
I am. So, hey, this was fun. I'm glad I got to participate in this, and I will talk to you to all three of you tomorrow.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Good.
Well, peace all right, out, man. And thank you guys. Thank you, Professor Reed.
Oh yeah.
For those of you that are patrons.
I just sign out of here and then
you go to the next one, and I'll take you to the champagne room.
Champagne room.
Yep. All right.
Thank you guys so much. We will see you shortly in the champagne room. We're coming right in. It's late. Pascal's got so much memeing to do, so we can't waste meme. We will see you shortly. Teray, thank you. Tell your lovely spouse, who's probably tapping her foot behind you, that we appreciate you being loaned out to us for the time being.
I will. Thank you. And you know she's a big fan of the show. She's watching right now. So I'll see you guys or talk to you guys tomorrow.
Peace.
All right.